Oh, look at you. It's so beautiful.
Bless. Oh, they're all down there. Shoot.
That's a gorgeous dress, Nicole.
Thank you.
Take good care of her.
Thank you.
Watch your dress on the steps and stay standing when you get to your places.
You good? You good? You good?
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always. We have come rejoicing into the house of the Lord for this celebration, dear brothers and sisters, and now we stand with Nicole and Ryan on the day they intend to form a home of their own. For them, this is a moment of unique importance. So let us support them with our affection, with our friendship, and with our prayer as their brothers and sisters. Let us listen attentively with them to the word that God speaks to us today. Then, with Holy Church, let us humbly pray to God the Father through Christ our Lord for this couple, his servants, that he lovingly accept them, bless them, and make them always one. Let us pray. Be attentive to our prayers, O Lord, and in your kindness uphold what you have established for the increase of the human race, so that the union you have created may be kept safe by your assistance. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a suitable partner for him." So the Lord God formed out of the ground various wild animals and various birds of the air, and he brought them to the man to see what he would call them. Whatever the man called each of them would be its name. The man gave names to all of the cattle, all of the birds of the air, and all of the wild animals, but none proved to be the suitable partner for the man. So the Lord God cast a deep sleep on the man, and while he was asleep, he took out one of his ribs and closed up the space with flesh. The Lord God then built into a woman the rib that he had taken from the man. When he brought her to the man said, "This one at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of her man this one has been taken. That is why a man leaves his father and mother and clings to his wife, and the two of them become one body." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, if God is for us, who can be against us? He did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all. Will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen ones? It is God who acquits us. Who will condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, rather was raised, who also is the right hand of God, and who indeed intercedes for us. What will separate us from the love of Christ? Will anguish or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or the sword? No, in all these things we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor present things nor future things, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor any other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he had sat down, his disciples came to him. He began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the clean of heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are they who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they insult you and persecute you and utter every kind of evil against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Saint Paul was fond of referring to Jesus Christ as the new Adam. We heard about Adam in today's first reading from the book of Genesis. And for our purposes here, I would suggest that the following verse from that reading is the one we need to focus our attention on. "So the Lord God cast a deep sleep on the man, and while he was asleep, he took out one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. The Lord God then built up into a woman the rib that he had taken from the man." And you know the rest of the story. The man said, "This one at last is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh." Now, that may seem to be a strange passage to focus on at a marriage homily, but I'd like for you to consider this, and I know it's not quite easily visible, but look at Christ on the cross, the new Adam. And what do you see? An opening in his side, just like the original Adam. And John's gospel tells us that from his side came forth water and blood. And the fathers of the church have always seen that as a symbol of the two sacraments, water, baptism, and blood, the Eucharist. And what do those two sacraments do but form the church, form the body of Christ here on earth? And what does St. Paul tell us that that church, that body of Christ, us, what does St. Paul tell us that is? It is the bride of Christ. From Adam, the original Adam's side, came his bride, Eve. From the side of Christ comes his bride, the church. Now that's important for us as we celebrate this marriage between Ryan and Nicole, because they are becoming a sacrament. We all know, we're all Catholic, most of us are Catholics here, and we all know, if you're my age or older, you know that a sacrament is an outward sign instituted by Christ to give grace. Yes, I even saw Grandpa mumbling the words with me there. Nicole and Ryan are the outward sign. They're what we can see. And they become the sacrament that gives us grace. Yes, they receive grace from the sacrament, but they become the sacrament because they become for us the visible image of Christ and his bride, the church. And as we look at them and see their love, we are reminded of the love Christ has for us, his spouse. And that's why St. Paul would go on to say that marriage is a mirror of Christ and his relationship with us. And that's why in the Catholic tradition, marriage is indissoluble, because Christ's love for us is indissoluble. And they are a mirror of that love. This is the great and momentous thing that Ryan and Nicole enter into today. We heard in the gospel the familiar passage from chapter 5 of Matthew, the Beatitudes. And as Ryan and Nicole enter into marriage, they give us those Beatitudes, they offer them to themselves as what they need to imitate in their marriage. They need to be poor in spirit. They need to be a compassionate couple who mourn not just over what mourns them, but mourn with their friends and family. They need to be meek and humble. They need to hunger and thirst for righteousness. The list goes on. You know it as well as I do. They do that not just for their own relationship, but they do that because they are the mirror of Christ's love for us. And Christ mourns with us and for us. Christ comforts us. Christ hungers and thirsts for righteousness. And so do they. And they inspire us to do the same. Weddings are always surrounded with many gifts. I remember when my own sisters were getting married, the gifts started arriving about a month ahead of time at the house. And we need to remember, Ryan and Nicole need to remember, that the greatest gift of this wedding, of this marriage, is not going to be received by them. It's going to be received by us. And they are the ones who give the gift. They give us the gift of their sacrament. They give us, and I know this will sound a little heretical, but I'll explain it. They give us God. How do I say that? First letter of John contains the most often quoted passage of the New Testament. Three words: God is love. When we see love, we see God. Look there. You see love. You see the face of God. That's the gift that they give to us. We rejoice in that gift. And we realize it's not always an easy gift to maintain. And so we're here to pray for them and for God's blessing upon them, that what God creates here today in their union with one another will endure forever and will forever give us the presence of God and remind us all of our dignity as the bride of Christ. Can you two stand up? Nice socks. Wedding party, stand. Okay, and I'm right in the center. I know you can't see it with your dress. Come up a little closer. Brian, come up a little closer. There we go. Not yet, not yet. Dearly beloved, you have come together into the house of the church so that in the presence of the church's minister and the community, your intention to enter into marriage may be strengthened by the Lord with a sacred seal. Christ abundantly blesses the love that binds you. Through a special sacrament, he enriches and strengthens those he has already consecrated by holy baptism, that they may be faithful to each other forever and assume all the responsibilities of married life. And so in the presence of the church, I ask you to state your intentions. Okay, these are the three questions. The first answer is I have. Ryan and Nicole, have you come here to enter into marriage without coercion, freely and wholeheartedly?
I have.
Next one's I am. Are you prepared as you follow the path of marriage to love and honor each other for as long as you both shall live?
I am.
This one's also I am. Are you prepared to accept children lovingly from God and to bring them up according to the law of Christ and his church?
I am.
Okay, give her your bouquet. Since it is your intention to enter into the covenant of holy matrimony, join your right hands and declare your consent before God and his church. Okay, look at her and repeat after me. I, Ryan.
Take you, Nicole.
To be my wife. I promise to be faithful to you. In good times and in bad. In sickness and in health. I will love you and honor you. All the days of my life. Okay, you look at him and repeat after me. I, Nicole.
Take you, Ryan.
To be my husband. I promise to be true to you. In good times and in bad. In sickness and in health. I will love you and honor you. All the days of my life. Okay, take a deep breath. May the Lord in his kindness strengthen the consent you have declared before the church and graciously bring to fulfillment his blessing within you. What God joins together, let no one put asunder. Amen. May the Lord bless these rings which you give to each other as a sign of love and fidelity. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, right. Take her ring and place it on her finger. That's good enough. And just look at her and repeat me. Nicole, receive this ring. As a sign of my love and fidelity. In the name of the Father.
And of the Son.
And of the Holy Spirit. Ryan, receive.
receive this ring. Look at him.
Ryan, receive this ring.
As a sign of my love and fidelity.
As a sign of my love and fidelity.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And of the Son.
And of the Son.
And of the Holy
and
Spirit.
And of the Holy Spirit.
Standing when you get back to your places. Okay, we're going to go up to our places, go back to your place. Please stand. Dear brothers and sisters, as we call to mind the special gift of grace and charity by which God has been pleased to crown and consecrate the love of our sister Nicole and our brother Ryan, let us commend them to the Lord.
For peace in our world, may all lands that suffer violence and injustice find peace and reconciliation. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the protection and sanctity of human life, from conception until natural death, may all people be treated with the dignity they deserve. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our guests gathered here today, may they enjoy the warm company of family and friends and have a safe journey home. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Ryan and Nicole, may they live long, blessed lives together. May their love grow stronger each and every day. And may they build a family rooted in faith and unconditional love. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of our loved ones who have gone before us, may they know the peace and fullness of eternal life with God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Singing.
May God, the Eternal Father, keep you of one heart in love for one another, that the peace of Christ may dwell in you and abide always in your home. Amen. May you be blessed in your children, have solace in your friends, and enjoy true peace with everyone. Amen. May you be witnesses in the world to God's charity, so that the afflicted and needy who have known your kindness may one day receive you thankfully into the eternal dwelling of God. Amen. Amen. And may Almighty God bless all of you who are gathered here in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I am honored to present Ryan and Nicole Thompson.
Gentlemen, put your hands together with the parents of our bride, John and Teresa Schutzman. Next up, the parents of our groom, Patrick and Sherry Thompson. All right, now we have our bridal party. You guys make some noise. Help me welcome in our first couple, Morgan Gunderson and Brian Schutzman. Next up, we have Kristen Daughters and Trevor McCormick. Make some noise for them. Our third couple, give it up for Rachel Kimmick and Connor Deenan. Make some noise, everybody, for Hillary Keller and Joe McAndrew. All right, you guys, give it up. We have one of our maid of honor this evening, Bridget Schutzman and Matthew Schutzman. Make some noise for them. All right, our matron of honor, Caroline Dury and Thomas Reine. You guys put your hands together for Caroline and Thomas. All right, our other matron of honor, Angela Dressman, and our best man of the evening, Brendan Thompson. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we need everyone to rise to your feet. Ladies and gentlemen, please start clapping those hands. Come on, everybody, make a lot of noise. Come on, get louder than that. Give it up for the reason we're all here this evening, Mr. and Mrs. Ryan and Nicole Thompson. Make some noise, everyone, for Mr. and Mrs. Ryan and Nicole Thompson.
Can everybody hear me all right? Are we getting back? All right. Well, we knew when putting together this schedule with the five-hour gap that we might have a few casualties. And I think I only had one high school friend not make it. So we appreciate you all putting on your best A game and making it. Yeah. But we knew it was a gamble. Scheduling this kind of sandwiched in between Thanksgiving and Christmas with the hustle and bustle of the holidays and the travel and everything going on, we knew it would preclude a lot of people from coming, so we truly appreciate you guys making the trip, making the effort to come. We know it wasn't easy. I know the majority of my side had to fly in, and I know a lot of Nicole's friends flew in. Just for reference, we have attendees from as far west as Hawaii and as far east as Ireland. So I think that's a pretty good representation. And I know Cincinnati Airport isn't the most convenient or the most inexpensive, so honest to God, we are very appreciative of you allocating the time and the resources necessary to make the trip. We do have a fun group here tonight. So we have high expectations for the dance floor. I think, where's Cher Bear? There's my mom, Cher Bear. I think she was putting in some work on the foam roller this afternoon, loosening up those muscles, making sure that she was firing on all cylinders tonight. And if some of you weren't as diligent as she was, don't worry, we've got a lot of doctors on hand, so you will be, you and nurses, you'll be in good shape. But I'm gonna hand it to my better half to say a few words.
Thank you all for coming. Like Ryan said, my half of the speech is actually to thank these people and also our families. This 10 months has gone by quickly and pretty much seamlessly, honestly, and I think that's because of the people that we're surrounded by. There has been very little stress projected on us from anyone around us. And that is because, again, look at these beautiful, wonderful people we're surrounded by. So thank you to all of you. I have to thank my parents, obviously, and the Thompsons as well, for being the first examples of love in our lives and teaching us how to love unconditionally and selflessly. We are both so blessed to be raised by two sets of wonderful parents that have really taught us, like I said, how to love each other. And to the Thompsons, I will tell you, my parents, well, anyone who knows my family knows that they teach us how to pray from the moment we know how to speak. And I have been praying for my future spouse from that day forward. So thank you for raising not only the man of my dreams, but the answer to 26 years of prayers. He truly is. We both are very blessed to have all of you here, so thank you so much.
And last thing, the old adage is, you are the company you keep. And when we look out and see all of you, except for a few outliers, I'd say we're doing a pretty damn good job. So thank you so much. We hope you guys have a great time. And again, we are so honored and so grateful that you guys could make it here.
You'll be hearing from me later with the toast, so we're going to keep this simple. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Bless us, O Lord, and these thy gifts, which we are about to receive from thy bounty through Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you.
Say that you stay.
Put your hands together with our toast this evening. Give it up for John, Brendan, Angela, and Caroline. Put your hands together for them, everyone.
Hello. My name is John Schutzman, and I'm the proud father of Nicole Christine Thompson. My wife, Teresa, who goes by Moti, by the way, along with Patrick and Sherry Thompson, would like to welcome you all here tonight on this most joyful and joyous occasion, the wedding of Ryan and Nicole Thompson. Ryan and I haven't seen too much of each other over the years because of the distance, so I haven't really gotten to know him all as well as I probably should. So, but this is my third daughter who's gotten engaged and then married. So when I got this text one morning that, Dr. Schutzman, I'd like to speak to you tonight, I knew what was coming. Now, since I hadn't had a lot of time to spend with Ryan, I said, what can I ask him that will make me sure that he's the right guy? So I got the call, and he was a little nervous, and he goes, I'd like to have the hand of your daughter in marriage. And I said, Ryan, do you know hangry? Anyone who knows Nicole knows when she gets hungry, you better get out of the way. Now, for the people over 60 that may not know what hangry means, hangry is a noun. A state of anger caused by the lack of food may evoke negative changes in the emotional state. And Nicole, would you agree? Feed me before I kill you. Now, one of the things that's really interesting, having three son-in-laws, is the lack of women in their home. Chase, my first son-in-law, was the only one of the three son-in-laws that has a sister at home. So they really didn't grow up with a lot of women. in the house. And so a man would be a fool to claim any expertise in women, but I do have some experience. I grew up with three sisters, a wife of 33 years, four daughters, and I've worked with probably 1,000 nurses. So I've learned a few things about what to do and what not to do. And so, Ryan, I introduce you to the old married guy's advice to the newly married male. There are three rules, Ryan. Now, the first is pass-fail. If you don't get this right, there's no help for you. And Brad Paisley phrased it well. You'll soon find out that ain't how it works. It's not who wears the pants, it's who wears the skirt. Now, in every rule, there's a carrot and a stick. So I'll give you the stick first. An experienced nurse one told me, don't piss us off. Because if mama ain't happy, nobody's happy. Now, the carrot is, voiced by Aretha Franklin, respect. R-E-S-P-E-C-T, find out what it means to me. And that gets you to the C level, Ryan. So, if you want to take it to that B level, we go to rule number two. A good woman is wise, shut up and listen. Now, Ryan, you're not too far out of high school to college to remember that guys do a lot of stupid things. And now we know why. For it has been clinically proven, and this is from The Guardian, after testing hundreds of men, to put it bluntly, testosterone makes men stupid. Okay? Now, after living with one of the wisest women I've ever met, Motie, there are many times that we've had some heated discussions. And I went to sleep only to realize how wise my wife was and to tell her that. Now, in the Old Testament, we're going to do a little Bible study here. Wisdom is always referred with feminine pronouns, she and her. And the wisest man in the Bible who asked for wisdom as his first gift was King Solomon. And when King Solomon talked about wisdom, and I'm going to say put the wise woman there, he said, I loved her and sought her from my youth. I desired to take her for my bride and become enamored with her beauty. I therefore determined to take her to share my life, knowing that she would be my counselor in prosperity and encouragement in cares and sorrow. And I really like that last line. But here we have the wisest man in the world. The wisest man in the world has testosterone on board. He gets old, and even before Viagra, he gets stupid. Because King Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines. And this definitely didn't make Mama happy. So, you've made it to the B level. The first two rules basically are make Mama happy. Okay? But now we're going to get a little serious, because to go to that A level, you just got to take it to the next level. And that's this one. Your spouse is your best friend. She is your best friend for life. Now, one of the things that Teresa and I over the years have really enjoyed noticing is what I call marital friendship, where you see a couple and you just know they're the best friends. And Ryan, I know you've had a tremendous teaching from your parents, because I see that marital friendship in your parents, in Patrick and Sherry. So I know you've had very good teachers. Now, here you are at the start of your wedding. Actually, we have a little color that was supposed to be blue up there, but it's green, so you just imagine it's a really beautiful sunset or whatever. So you have this beautiful mountain scene, there's clouds, but what you have to realize is below those clouds are raging rivers, stinky muddy swamps, deep valleys, and some steep cliffs. So how do you get through? Well, this morning you entered into a sacramental covenantal marriage between yourself and Christ. Sacramental, as Father mentioned, a sign given by Christ to provide grace all through your relationship together. But you entered into a covenant, not a contract. A contract is an exchange of possessions. You entered into a three-way marriage covenant, which is a commitment between yourself and Christ. So why is this different from any other ceremony? Because in a marital covenant, let me just go to one more thing here. Luke Schutzman, my nephew, tried to illustrate, help me illustrate this, and we used a three-leg table. Because in a marital covenant, Christ is the third leg of your marriage commitment, represented by this three-legged table. He is an ancient sequoia supporting your marriage, especially when you are weak and frail and feel you can't go on. So many today want to do it on their own. We want to ignore Christ, and when the times get tough, we're too weak and frail, and by doing it on our own, we know that a two-legged table will not stand. Luke also helped me illustrate this. Basically, the couple is being assisted through Christ through the many trials and tribulations that marriage provides. So, we're back at that beginning of your relationship. We know that it's you two with Christ, but even with Christ, there will be times where you'll be begging for the life of a child, possibly a spouse with cancer, and you just don't understand why those prayers aren't going to be answered or aren't being answered. And there's a Christian singer named Lauren Daigle who really moved me over the last, Gail Mazanowski introduced me to her, and I really like the refrain of this song. When you don't move those mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. And over the last 10 years, there have been times where I've even looked at my wife and I said, how can you not say, why did this happen? And she said to me in her wisdom, you know, in this world, we're not always supposed to understand, but we're to trust. And so it's one of the things that has really helped us through our marriage. Now, when I was in high school, I was kind of a geek and I liked poetry. And a friend of mine introduced me to this poem called The Rabbi Ben Ezra by Robert Browning. And I've always enjoyed reading it at weddings. Grow old along with me, the best is yet to be. The last of life for which the first was made. Our times are in his hand. Who saith the whole I planned? Youth shows but half. Trust in God, see all, be not afraid. And so to that guy in the back that said, when are you going to get to the toast? We're at the toast here. Okay. Will you raise your glasses, please? May you have a long and joyful life together. May your children and your grandchildren rejoice in your love for each other. And at the end of the days, your days, may you spend eternity with our most merciful Savior. God bless you both.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Hi everyone, I'm Caroline and this is Angela and we are Nicole's two older sisters. We still can't believe we're standing up here today giving your maid of honor speech. When we think of Nicole, we think of her at about 6 years old, weighing about 30 pounds, with the longest, skinniest legs you've ever seen and a tiny torso. To paint you a picture, she looked a lot like Kermit the Frog. That being said, she was the absolute cutest of us all and the sweetest. Nicole, you have grown into a gorgeous woman who anyone would be lucky to have as a wife. You're one lucky man, Ryan.
It has been such a blessing to see Nicole develop into the beautiful woman she is today and choose the best college out there, St. University. I remember when she was originally looking for colleges, she was looking for a Midwestern Jesuit nursing school, and she got it down to Marquette and Xavier. I lived in Cincinnati at the time, so I definitely wanted her to go to Xavier. But as everyone knows, Nicole hates cold weather. So when it was emphasized to her just how cold Marquette was, she quickly chose Xavier, which we were very happy about. And not only was it the right choice because it was warmer than Marquette, but that's where she became a nurse and met the love of her life. But not until the last 2 weeks before graduation. Their love story began on senior week, which is the two-week period between finals and graduating. Both Ryan and Nicole's group of friends met at a bar, and in Nicole's own words, she looked up from her conversation and happened to lock eyes with Ryan's baby blues. He was in another less than interesting conversation and mouthed to Nicole, "Save me." And so their love story began.
After graduation, Nicole moved to Dallas in 2014. My husband John and I were fortunate enough to spend time with Nicole and Ryan alone when he came into town. Before I begin this story, however, I'd like to give you a little backstory on Nicole, which everybody probably already knows. All through high school and college, she was the girl every guy wanted to date. She was, true. She was and still is incredibly beautiful, smart, funny, kind, genuine, and an all-around real catch. But whenever Nicole allowed a guy to take her out on a date, she was never into the whole PDA thing. If a guy wanted to hold her hand or put his arm around her, she didn't want nothing to do with it. Now back to the story. So Ryan came to visit. We all went out to dinner and then walked around in the city. Our first impression of Ryan was he was tall, handsome, charming, successful, and funny. Safe to say, we were skeptical. Nicole and Ryan were walking in front of John and myself, and Ryan put his arm around Nicole's shoulder as they walked. In my head, I'm thinking, oh boy, now he's done it. But Nicole did nothing except moving closer to Ryan. As we continued walking, he slipped his hand into her hand, and again, she did nothing but held his hand a little tighter. At this point, my jaw was literally on the ground. I was in shock, but I also realized there must be something pretty special about this guy. Of course, as we got to know Ryan better, we saw all the amazing qualities Ryan has. Ryan, thank you for being a kind, patient, loving, supportive, understanding, and a true gentleman. And Mr. and Mrs. Thompson, thank you so much for raising Ryan to be the amazing man he is for our sister.
A very wise family friend, who is here tonight, used to tell us, in a relationship, both people should feel they are getting the better end of the deal. When you are with Nicole and Ryan, you can really sense this in their love and respect for each other. They speak so highly of each other and truly make each other so, so happy. Ryan, we are so excited to have another brother, but I hope you are mentally, physically, and emotionally prepared to have three sisters, two more brothers, and eight wild nieces and nephews. Congratulations, Nicole and Ryan. We love you both so much. Please raise your glasses for a toast. Nicole and Ryan, from this day on, you are never alone. Wherever you are, your spouse is your home. Now you are married. You are husband and wife. You'll be each other's joy, purpose, and reason for life. But when time has passed and the two of you age and your lives are about to turn the last page, you'll see not the wrinkles, the old, or the gray. Instead, you'll see yourselves as you are on this perfect wedding day. To Nicole and Ryan, may God bless you both with a long, happy, and blessed marriage.
First off, I'd like to thank Dr. and Mrs. Schussman for helping make this wonderful evening possible, so thank you. And to the rest of you all, thank you all for coming to help us celebrate the love between these two characters, Ryan and Nicole. So I'm not up here to tell any crazy embarrassing stories about Ryan or anything, because I would never do such a thing, and two, neither would he. Kid would never give me that kind of material to work with. You know, so he's never done anything wrong in his life, and you know, it was always like that growing up. I would definitely be the one getting in trouble all the time, and he would make the point of being the first one to let me know about it. You know, it was always like he was nagging me for this, that, and the other thing. You know, like, Brennan, you're watching TV, did you do homework? Yeah, Ryan, I did my homework, thanks, guy. But, you know, the older I got, and as one might say, the more mature I got, I started to realize that, you know, he was actually just trying to be the best older brother he could be, and he was always looking out for me, and actually had my best interests at heart. You know, and it's not just me, you know, he looks out for everyone. So the day he stops preaching to you about proper diet and exercise and where the best places to invest your money are, you know, that's the day you know he stopped caring about you. And, you know, he's always been wise and mature beyond his years. So along those lines, I think Aunt Kay said it best. You know, she said that Ryan will never be truly and completely happy until he settles down, gets married, has a few lanky children, and has a nice hefty mortgage that he needs to pay off. You know, I don't know if that was the exact quote, but in terms of sentiment, I think she definitely hit the nail right on the head. So I'm definitely glad to see that Ryan has found the most important piece of that happiness, which is the beautiful young lady sitting right by his side. I remember the first time I heard about Nicole, as everyone mentioned, it was, you know, towards the end of their senior year. I think it was either Trevor or Thomas, probably a combination of the two, who kind of predicted this whole situation from the future, or from the beginning, I don't know what I'm saying. I just remember that people were talking about how, like, Ryan met this girl and he was madly in love with her and never wanted to meet anyone else again. So naturally I was skeptical, but, you know, over the next few months and then years after getting the chance to spend time with Nicole, whether it was here in the Cincinnati area just hanging out or in Connecticut for various holidays, and then of course a nice little European excursion. You know, after having the pleasure of getting to know her, you know, I had this little bittersweet realization. And the only bitter part was having to admit that Ryan was right about something yet again. And that this girl is actually amazing. So, Nicole, you're awesome. Couldn't be happier to have you joining the squad. I know Mom is. She's sick of hanging out with a bunch of guys being dudes. Anyway, so... Nicole, couldn't be more excited, Ryan, even though there were definitely a few years where, as many people in this room can attest, I wasn't exactly your biggest fan. I always have weirdly looked up to you, and it definitely doesn't stop now, so you better stay on your A game. Anyway, Nicole, you rock. Ryan, you're a solid role player. Let's go, guys.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you notice on your tables, there are candles in front of each of you. Nicole and Ryan would like to invite everyone to please take their candles and get up and surround the dance floor. Once again, they would like to ask everyone to please get your candle.
But I can
Make some noise for Mr. and Mrs. Ryan and Nicole Thompson. You guys, put your hands together for Nicole and her dad.
Colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the
sky are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying how do you do? They're really saying I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They learn much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Everyone, put your hands together for Ryan and his mom. Everybody squeeze in. You guys got to move over and get nice and tight. Get shoulder to shoulder. Get nice and close, everyone. Everybody look up here towards the camera. All right. You guys, Nicole and Ryan, hope you're having a great time here at the reception. They want everyone to stay out there with them so we can start this party. Don't anybody go anywhere.
Say you act raps, they like save the time. I can dance all me, I don't two-step. Y'all looking at something like a true player. A girl told me that a man that could dance might could possibly get down with a two. kids. Tell them odds and to make them love you stronger. I wanna go all night longer. A couple rounds going down like water. I wanna go all night longer. Cause I do this every night. Cause I do this every night. I wanna do this every night. A couple rounds going down like water. I wanna go all night longer.
You guys, do me a favor, everybody out there, put your hands together one more time. Make some noise for Mr. and Mrs. Ryan and Nicole Thompson. You guys, that's going to do it. Nicole and Ryan, hope you had a great time at the reception. You guys, everybody be careful going home. We'll see you again real soon.